Exterior, Rehoboth Beach, sunrise. A jetliner flies in front of the sun, then a sky view of Rehoboth Beach. A twink, beautiful Matt, is loudly singing the Golden Girls theme while walking the beach.
Thank you for being a friend, traveling down the road and back again.
We see more of the boardwalk, the trash, a Rehoboth Beach sign, someone passed out by an arcade holding a stuffed poodle, and the Blue Chicken Beach Bar. The overall feel is that of a very homosexual frat house the morning after a party.
Your heart is true, you're a pal and a confidant.
Beautiful Matt walks by a busted house on the beach, and we see Maurice stick his head out the window.
Quiet!
Interior, Golden Gaze household kitchen. Maurice, 60s, a Dorothy type in a blue housecoat, pops his head back inside.
Hello, Maurice.
Go away.
You gonna watch us play at drag volleyball later?
Maurice slams the window shut. Stan, earnest, rose-like in his 50s, 60s, is in the living room doorway, shirtless.
No music. Oh, but think of the children, Captain.
Oh, if I wanted to hear the cocks crow at sunrise, Fraulein, I'd still be in Ma's house in Little Italy.
It's sweet. The twink has a tune in his heart.
And he should keep it there.
Back in the Navy, when guys were chipper.
What? A chipper?
Well, hi. I taught them the South Pacific album in the group showers. But there's no coffee.
But there's tea. Spill, Maria. Did you turn the Navy homosexual or just the Pacific Fleet?
Oh, they weren't gay. They only wanted to sing, "There's Nothing Like a Dame."
You're a vintage stereotype. I should turn you into GLAD.
Tennessee enters. 60s, artistic, vain, sexually frustrated Blanche type. Posing languidly in the doorway in a fabulous silk robe. Eyes on Stan. Showing off a freshly bathed, fluffy puppy, Stella, in his hands.
Hello, Stanley. Here she is, all bathed and scented. A fresh little bitch. Smell her.
Stan ignores him. Maurice walks by Stella and smells Tennessee instead.
Still smells like Southern comfort to me.
Yes, Maud. Mama is hung. I need coffee.
Well, there is no coffee.
Anywhere, the end of civilization.
There's tea. Caffeinated, too.
Sometimes there is a god. So quickly.
I'm reporting us all.
But Maurice, you always buy us coffee.
Oh, you poor sweet things. This time I didn't. But you're welcome to go get it yourselves.
But where?
How?
It's called store. Not far from there. You can even trot down there in your Tory Burch thongs.
Well, you know I spent all I have growing my roses. 10. Can you go buy us coffee? I want it with my morning cupcake.
Oh, hunty, bye. You know I don't do capitalism. Maud. Whatever happened to your coffee fund?
Well, there was last month's rent to pay and my and Stella's arthritis medication. Plus, I invested in silicone tits for Dee Dee.
Stan absently unwraps his cupcake like Lucille Bluth.
Good for her.
Oh, no. So we're flat broke?
We're broke, Tan. We're not flat.
There is the sound of tires screeching and a car honking. Then a shadowed figure appears behind the glass front door.
Madison!
The lease renewal!
The pet surcharge! Where's Stella?
Stella! Stella!
Madison Fancy, artificially ageless landlord, greedy local mogul, and drag star, enters of her own accord, wearing a Sunset Boulevard turban and a beach cover-up. Like Joan Crawford, she never leaves the house out of character.
Oh, tenants! I have your new lease on life.
Stella! Stella!
Stella? Who is Stella? An illegal copulation doll? A stowaway twinket? A puppy? All will cost you.
Tennessee, sensing opportunity in crisis, struts over to a shouting Stan like the famous scene from A Streetcar Named Desire, where Stella Kowalski slinks into Marlon Brando's arms. Maurice is quick on the uptake.
No, of course not. We're rehearsing.
Tennessee clutches Stan's head to his torso, then raises him and begins kissing Stan. Stan, stunned, picks him up and walks them out of the room entwined, just like Brando.
Community theater, how committed. You may sign the lease now or never, as I have several clients who would give up dick for this dump.
Madison, this is a 20% increase. We can't afford it.
I suppose you could always move inland.
Where the straight people are?
Teeming with them. Life's full of tough choices, isn't it?
You goddamn sea witch. I'll sign.
Good. First month due in 1 week. And if you are stowing another bitch away in this kennel, there'll be a pet fee for your little dog, too. Cheerio.
Stella, where are you, girl?
Stella finally enters from the living room, dragging Tennessee's silk robe in her mouth.
Oh, no, Stan!
Maurice runs to the living room doorway to shout inside.
Insane! Are insane!
Act 1. Interior, Golden Gay's household living room, later that day. Maurice is sitting on the sofa in the cluttered room, reading a newspaper. Tennessee is painting a picture we cannot see. Stan is flipping tarot cards while doing yoga poses and munching on candy.
It's chilly for September. May we turn up the...
No.
Why not?
Because without consulting us, Maud here signed a lease with Benny Coffin III for twice what we can afford. And since she's the only city gent who's making money, she's punishing her La Vie Bohème roommates with strict austerity. Isn't that right, Chancellor?
I work as a drag queen, Frida Kahlo, and it's not punishment, it's a necessity.
We live with Angela Merkel. Stan, no fun ever. 999.
Oh, you okay, honey?
Girl, I'm leaving. I'll open a restaurant in Santa Fe.
Will the restaurant serve microwave cooking for one?
The Queen of Cups. Help is on the way, sailors. But for now, Maurice, could you light my Betty candle for me for a little heat?
Maurice rolls his eyes, pulls matchsticks from a drawer, and lights the St. Betty White candle on the coffee table. Stan pulls his mat closer, shivering for effect. Maurice tosses him matches.
Here, little match crone. Don't get hypothermia. We don't have the insurance.
Namaste.
And Ted, I know you're secretly happy we're staying beachside.
Oh, I'm over the moon, Dana Delaney. This is my over the moon face.
You'll see. I'm always right.
Willa, I can do my art anywhere, but heaven forfend Gladys Kravitz gives up her tweak pinking window upstairs.
Well, in the immortal words of Carrie Fisher.
Please, Maurice. I'm sorry you've had to cover my rent lately. I will pay you back when the flowers bloom.
Dan here thinks money grows on rose bushes.
It better.
I'll have plenty of customers. I've been manifesting them in my meditations. But I should tell you something.
You absolutely should not.
I hired someone.
What? What? Why?
To clean.
Ooh, one of those naked cleaning otters they shut down on Craigslist?
It was before the rent hike. I was going to tell you. I'm so organized, and you both are, well, so not.
Dan, it's not Grey Gardens.
Stella begins to pee behind Tennessee's easel as he paints.
Really? Because Stella is having a tinkle on Ten's painting.
I'm glad she is. I'm glad somebody's doing something they want to do.
Maurice, we're days away from a raccoon infestation. I can't stand this. Sometimes I get so frustrated I could...
Well, actually hurt a fly.
Yes, and a few desperate times I have.
Now, thank you. You need to call this cleaner right now and cancel, because we can't afford even...
Stan's custom-made Elaine Stritch doorbell rings on repeat until answered.
And I'm here! Look who's here! I'm still here!
Oh. Damn it, your doorbell terrifies me! Ma has finally tracked me down.
I thought your ma died.
That's why it's so terrifying.
And I'm here! Look who's here!
Well, what do I do?
Make it stop!
Maurice opens the door, silencing Elaine. Quentin, Mimi, 70s, 80s, effeminate, slothful, and vaguely aristocratic, poses at the door with a carpet bag, flamingo umbrella, coral-knitted scarf, some light makeup, and long silver hair in a sort of old maid's pompadour.
It's her. It's the person. She's answered my advertisement.
Rosy cheeks and everything.
Well, who are you?
My parents, like all my rivals, called me Quentin. But since this appears to be a boarding home for incorrigible queers like myself, I invite you to call me Mimi, at your leisure, of course.
Well, Mimi, yeah. I am so sorry, but we really don't...
What he means is, what are your pronouns?
Well, I invite he, she, they, and of course, for my intimates, Vivian.
Vivian.
Mm-hmm. And one of you gentle people would be Stanley, would you not be?
Yes, that's I would be.
And you put out a notice for a kind and conversational special someone to help around this hobbit hole.
We could use it. It looks like Joan Rivers exploded in here.
Mimi steps over a pile of drag body parts and wipes a banister, where St. Rue, St. B, and St. Estelle candles have burned to the bottom, with a white-gloved finger, graying the glove and causing Ten to sneeze from the dust, and Maurice to cross his arms.
I do see the issue.
So you'll clean?
I'll help.
Amy walks over to Tennessee, still painting.
Ah, what's this? You know, in my youthful days, I was an artist model for sketch classes for Desperate Housewives. So I could be quite useful to you with your vintage style. I pose in loving memory for time gone by, like this.
Why, thank you. I wouldn't want to pose.
No imposition. You'd see it is easier for me to pose than not.
Listen, I'm sorry, but how you seem marvelously peculiar. There's been a mistake. We just can't pay you right now.
On the matter of wages, your reference was very obscure, I'll admit. Perhaps a trial period would be wise?
Trial period?
Well, never mind payment for now. I'll happily accept nourishment and lodging instead. I'll give you 1 week and then I'll decide. There exists a kitchen, of course, I presume.
Through that door.
Oh, sensational. I assume you stocked with all the usual delights. You all relax. I shall be back with Gimlet slushies for the house.
Mimi gathers some dirty cups on the coffee table and then briefly poses regally in the doorway for 10 before exiting into the kitchen, carrying her carpet bag with her.
Is Mimi moving in?
Well, I, for one, love Vivian. She smells like Chanel No. 5 and cock-a-licky soup.
Well, I have to go to a place called work, you know, to earn that silly thing called money. Fix it.
Maurice grabs his silicone breasts and begins to exit.
And you two. I don't care if you need to charge for happy endings on Geriatric Grindr. We need cash now.
Maurice slams the door shut. There's the sound of breaking glass from the kitchen.
Oh, whoop. And a new blender.
About a new plan. Mimi, you're taking us beach bar hopping.
Oh, delightful. You'll have a jolly time with Mimi.
The devil. I think we should be careful.
Mimi brings them close. Her carpet bag is bulging.
My dears, we can't just sit around like human beings. The devil exists to be danced with. Off you go. Scoot, scoot.
They all scurry out the door. End of Act 1. Act 2. Exterior. Establishing shot blue chicken, well after midnight. A neon blue rooster blinks on and off. We also see a bunch of flyers on the window, including one for Labor Day drag volleyball. Interior, blue chicken bar area, same time. It's near closing. The bar area around Maurice is a diverse assortment of regulars. Young beach twinks are gathered in the karaoke area. Maurice is behind the bar. In drag is Dee Dee, sorta busted. It's been a long night.
Last call!
Cock-a-doodle-doo!
Beautiful Matt, the singing twink, approaches the bar.
Sex on the beach?
Just tell me when, hon.
Now.
Sorry, hon, you're not my type.
Enter Catherine the Great, a Russian lesbian in period gown and crown who walks up to the bar like she owns it. Because she does.
Yeah. What's the story, boss?
Women can't live with them. Pass the vodka rocks.
I can offer Skittles.
What pretty little rocks. Now, pass the vodka.
Maurice offers a shot. Catherine dumps some Skittles in the shot glass and throws it back.
Let's see that rainbow.
Give me another. The world is cruel, and I wanna see the stars.
Maurice turns around to type up a bill. Enter Stan, Tennessee, and Mimi, intoxicated and carrying boardwalk prize animals, who shush each other and sneak by Maurice to the other end of the bar. Stan swipes the Skittles.
Now, Madame President.
At the end of the bar, drag queen Buttery Males is in a pantsuit, blonde wig, and small black mourning veil, which covers her face. Hillary Clinton as Miss Havisham vibes.
Now, we need anything else over here?
The veiled drag queen scribbles a note, and Maurice picks it up.
$79,646 votes across 3 states. Anything else to drink?
She scribbles another note and passes it.
A Chardonnay. Come in.
And we'll have what she's having.
Buttery Males politely shakes Mimi's hand.
Mimi, pleased to meet you.
That's Buttery Males.
Buttery Males?
What? Her email.
Ah.
What are you all doing here?
We took Mimi on the town.
Well, I'm not giving her drowsy chaperones anything to drink.
What?
Yes, please.
Fine. You're all getting yellowtail.
Buttery Males pops her head up in alarm.
Oh, not you, darling.
On the other side of the room, the karaoke DJ, CJ, has taken the mic.
Thanks for allowing that break. Now remember, always tip your DJ. Next up, we have... Oh, what a shock. Matt.
A bunch of twinks, presumably all named Matt, look confused.
Sorry, Matt. Beautiful Matt, it's you?
Thank you. Matt takes the mic. Other Matts looked insulted.
Thank you. This old-time classic means a lot to me. You could say it's my truth.
We hear the opening bars of Christina Aguilera's Beautiful.
Stan, take him into the forest and kill him and bring me back the hardest proof, please.
Maurice brings his boss another shot.
Your Imperial Majesty, I've got a favor to ask.
Speak.
Do you think I could take an extra shift or maybe an advance? See, I need them.
Lady Maud, as of the stroke of 12, we are no longer your empress.
You're kidding.
We do not kid. The blue chicken has endured a hostile takeover.
By whom?
A familiar screech of tires is heard outside.
Her.
The ice woman, come on.
My God, what have you done?
We hear Madison's footsteps and the door opening.
You're so sorry.
Live by the coup, die by the coup.
She'll be paying me next to nothing.
Catherine seems to briefly sober up and caresses Maurice's face.
I beg you all, take courage. The brave soul can mend even disaster.
Catherine the Great removes her crown and sets it on the bar. She offers her hand, and Maurice kisses it. Mimi offers a curtsy.
The Empress is dead.
Long live the queen.
Your majesty.
More like Hail Satan.
I'm afraid my old needs no longer bend.
Maurice Arthur, Didi, my tenant, and now my employee too. Welcome to my company beach town.
Well, if it isn't old Madison Fancy buying yet another landmark of Rehomo, Madison Kiki Park, Madison Kai Kai Arcade, Madison Reading Library. You're gonna name the blue chicken after yourself too, or is it too close? Or is it close enough as it is?
All in good time, Shapoopy. Now, I have a proposition for you.
Oh, really?
Yes. A competition dropped out of the annual drag volleyball game. A pity, really. Hopper overdoses, I hear.
We'll never play drag volleyball with you.
There's a $2,000 cash prize for the winner.
Well, where and when, darling?
2 days. Poodle Beach. High noon. The drag theme is 80s television divas. Not, unfortunately for you, divas in their 80s.
You're going to lose.
False bravado. How cute. Stretch those calcified limbs, darling. Oh, and one more thing. A little fun challenge. You need to get every single filthy peasant out of here in 5 minutes, or the cops will arrive with fines. And that's about your check.
Madison turns to beautiful Matt at the mic.
What is wrong with you? This is a happy place. Keep singing. Cheerio. Cheerio, darlings. Don't you all get busted.
I am beautiful, no matter what they say.
Everyone, you need to get out. Go home.
No one moves.
Words can't bring me down. I am beautiful in every single way.
Hey, the cops are coming!
The mats look excited.
Maud, the cops are their daddy.
Well, how do I get them out of here then?
Tell them some gay icon is performing down at the beach.
Barbara's down at the Blue Oyster.
The mats do not react.
Oh, bless them. They don't know who that is. Hey, boys, RuPaul is down at Can't Be David's.
The mats roll their eyes.
Auntie, they pulled Ru for fracking.
Again. Oh, what?
Gen Z, baby. You know their power.
It's chilling.
Oh, I'll take care of this. Youthful gentleman, your beloved American icon, Carol Channing, is performing next door.
The mats do not react.
Pity, was she canceled as well?
Oh, she did.
Oh, dear. The world has gotten so terribly, terribly old.
My God, who would these dead-eyed twinks rush out to see?
Tennessee is furiously Googling on his phone.
I don't know any of who these Gen Z icons even are. I mean, who's a Babadook?
All of you are overthinking this. There is literally only one living icon who could clear this entire room.
Britney's on the beat.
Britney!
Free Britney! Free Britney!
The mats hurry to leave, followed by Buttery Mail shuffling behind in solidarity. As the foursome exits, two cops arrive at the door.
Hey, you're cutting it close. Maurice, we're gonna have to fine you.
Rubbish! You have no power here. Be gone before I drop, before Gen Z drops a Babadook on you.
Mimi nudges the frightened cops out of the way and leads everyone out.
I think she's a keeper, Dee Dee.
Well, we'll see. Be sure to get some sleep, boys. Tomorrow we learn how to play volleyball.
Cut to black. Exterior, Golden Gaze household, the next day. A storm approaches. Lightning strikes close by. Interior, Golden Gaze household living room, same time. Mimi, wearing Tennessee's silk bathrobe, is ambling around the messy living room with a feather duster, picking up various pieces of clutter to inspect the dust underneath, and then plopping various expensive-looking objects in her carpet bag.
If I've learned anything in life, it's that after 3 years, the dust won't get any worse. Ah, time for elevensies.
Mimi scoops her tea bag out and stirs the teacup and lounges on the sofa. There's a sudden crack of lightning as rain pours outside.
Oh, that's a shame. Here they come.
You're still here.
And queer, and used to it.
Squatting.
And how did rugby practice go? So sorry I couldn't join you. So busy with all this mess.
Volleyball practice. And, well...
I hated it so much! Balls, balls, balls! Hitting the side of my face! Breathing heat, heaving breaths.
What 10 means is, it's not our game.
Well, I enjoyed it.
Well, that's true. Balls in the face is your game.
Mimi picks up a tea bag.
A most dangerous game. Reminds me, fancy a cup of tea, anyone?
Tennessee nods yes and sits. Mimi pours a cup. Water drips from Tennessee's nose into it.
I'm going to fetch you all some fresh towels.
We're gonna be humiliated.
Come on, I taught you to set and pass. Just pass the ball to me.
Ken doesn't really pass the ball as much as the balls pass him.
Well, honey, at least I can pass as a gorgeous woman when I want to. What 80 diva are you gonna be? Alf?
Hey, that's over the line.
Maurice rips off Tennessee's headscarf.
At least I have hair.
Tennessee and Maurice begin to wrestle, delicately.
Hey now, break it up. Calm down. Calm down!
Yes, let's all be calm like Stan. I'd be calm too if I had no job and could spend all day snacking and singing and butthole sunning on my yoga mat.
That's enlightened self-care, and I've earned the right to live my life the way I like.
Yeah, as long as I'm bankrolling it.
Oh, let's get real, Melanie Griffith. You love being the working girl. You love the whole Alice doesn't live here anymore, struggling widowed mother, raising the kids with piano bar tips vibe you give off. Your Roseanne Barr domestic goddess yelling with love shtick. Your one day at a time plucky white lady with drug addict teenage daughters.
Ten. We get it.
Yes. I do get it. Both of you use me. so you can live like children. I financed this place as your art studio, which hasn't sold a piece in months. And you, Stan, treat this place like your own bathhouse, and you don't even share your tricks or charge admission. Oh, life has not been kind to either of you, but you need to get it through your heads that I am not your mother.
Fine. We'll leave.
Go ahead.
Hey, now.
We're going, and you'll be begging for us back.
Why the hell would I do that?
Because you don't want to die alone.
Everyone freezes. Enter Mimi with towels, who reads the room. She responds by singing.
The clothes you're wearing are the clothes you wore.
She slowly passes the warm towels to each person, almost lovingly drying them off.
The smile you are smiling, you were smiling then, but I can't remember where or when.
Mimi takes Tennessee's hand, who's by the door, and leads him closer to Maurice by the sofa.
Some things that happened for the first time seem to be happening again.
And so it seems that we have met before, and laughed before, and loved before. But who knows where or when?
Everyone has been brought together.
Well, you're no Peggy Lee.
I love that song.
Oh, you love Rodgers and Hart too?
More like he literally believes in reincarnation.
I think we play our parts again and again until we get it perfect.
Stan glances at the St. B. Betty Rue candles. Tennessee grabs Maurice's hand.
I'm so sorry. I didn't mean.
Yes, you did.
It's not true.
Of course it's true. But that's not why I want you to stay.
We're not leaving.
I don't want to leave.
Good. You're my friends, and I love you. I've loved you since the night we first all met.
Oh, the Sylvester concert.
I remember. The happiest night of my life.
Well, we love you too, Maurice.
But it can't stay like this with this imbalance of effort.
Yes, you are getting too old to be a hard-working sugar daddy.
No. You're too old to be my sugar babies. Who do you think you are? Like Tom Daly?
Tennessee walks to his mystery painting.
But I don't want to lose my time to create.
You might need to lose some of it.
We should be a team.
Yes, a team. We were a team the other night.
You mean a team that's going to lose tomorrow?
Oh, I am dreading tomorrow too, you know? It's not the same as being on the drag stage indoors. We don't all have beach bodies like Stan, Lord knows, with his diet.
Oh, it's easy. I just think healthy and eat what I want. We need to think we will win. And one way or another, we'll win.
What is that? Your Taoist mantra? The secret?
See it and be it.
It's the power of attraction.
I see you took the RuPaul masterclass. How much did that cost me?
It worked for Rue.
Apparently not. The kids canceled her.
Well, I believe we're going to lose.
Well, maybe, but you could lose fabulously.
Well, that's nice. We need to win or we're out of here. And you'll never get paid.
Mimi goes around the room and begins picking up pieces of clothing and wigs, and then channels Tony Kushner.
My queens, fabulous is not delineated by age or beauty. It is raw materials reworked into illusion. It is the rapturous embrace of difference, the discovery of self in that which makes you the other.
Everyone in this little gay town is the other, Mimi.
Ah, but you are surrounded by such sparkling youth and are old.
Timothy slaps Mimi across the face.
Oh, well, I'm so sorry. That's an involuntary reaction.
I know the truth hurts, dear, and hurt people hurt back.
Oh, really?
Tennessee sees that the tussle has knocked over Mimi's carpet bag with various items spilling out.
And is that my wrinkle cream?
And my Les Mis Broadway prop silver candlesticks?
By the way, are they real silver?
I knew it! You're a scam artist!
Oh, you called me an artist. Now, you must understand, I am indeed a fabulous vagrant. I do not cook, I do not clean. I am eBay seller Nanny Knickknacks 43. I've tried not to take anything you truly miss.
Get out.
Mimi, really?
I'm sorry, I did love it here. I feel understood.
Oh, Mimi, you're so sweet. Consider the candlesticks a gift. She doesn't have to go, right, Maurice? Besides, we need her on our volleyball team.
How many are on a volleyball team anyway?
More than three.
Hey, can you wear my robe?
Yes, but it sparked an idea. For tomorrow, if you'll forgive me, allow me to atone for my horrible manners.
Mm-hmm. And what's the idea?
One could say it is golden.
Act 3. Exterior, Poodle Beach Volleyball Court, the next day. A crowd has set some chairs up to watch the game. Among them are some of the Twink Mats, Buttery Males, and Catherine the Great. Many are holding drinks. CJ the DJ enters and grabs a microphone connected to a boombox.
Good morning, Poodle Beach! Look at all of you who made it out of the house before noon. Foxes, otters, bears, oh my. We are just minutes away from this year's Labor Day Drag Volleyball Showdown. And since this year's theme is 80s television divas, this year, we have a cash prize on the line because Reed is good!
The crowd cheers. Someone blows up a giant inflatable pink poodle.
Our first team, hailing from the Mile High City with the Mile High Shoulders, those vintage Real Housewives of Oil Country, the Dynasty Divas!
Enter Alexis, or Madison Fancy, as Alexis Carrington, along with three other athletic-looking queens, all drinking from champagne glasses. They include a Krystal Carrington, a Dominique Deveraux, and a Sammy Joe. They perform a chain of playful bitch slaps. Sammy Joe, who has the biggest build, spikes the volleyball in a show of dominance.
Ooh, cats are out of the bag and ready to scratch. Meow. And now, your challengers, these broads barely outrunning menopause, hailing all the way from Miami, Florida, the Golden Girls!
Maurice as Dorothy, Tennessee as Blanche, Stan as Rose, and Mimi attempting her best Sophia enter in wigs and bathrobes, with Blanche carrying a tray of shots.
Cheesecake shot, my daddy's old southern recipe. Come and get it, boys.
Twink surged toward the shots.
No need to form a line. Blanche can handle all of you at once.
Please, keep it to 5 or 6 at a time. I'm a lady.
They pass out cheesecake shots to the audience. The Dynasty Divas are putting dark eyeshadow on each other's cheeks like football players. Dominique, in white furs, approaches the net, eye to eye with Tennessee.
And would you fry hag be wearing bathrobe for this bout of San Polo?
Tennessee moves even closer, nose to nose with Dominique, face to face with an evil twin.
Well, we're certainly not wearing furs, Mrs. Deveraux. You prepared for a beach battle.
Tennessee moves as if to remove her bathrobe, then chickens out.
Rose, would you be a doll? I've decided you're stripping first.
The three rip Stan's bathrobe off, revealing Stan's perfect torso in a two-piece 80s swimsuit.
Oh!
Ooh!
Stan looks to her teammates for support, and Tennessee, Maurice, and Mimi sheepishly follow suit, removing their robes and revealing their suits.
Oh, please. Rose won the Viking genetic lottery. Your future is me, Mats. First it's Twink, then it's Twonk, and then it's Trunked.
The young crowd looks stricken by the prophecy. Madison points to Maurice and Mimi.
Look, divas, the Italians shave their lady forests. All for us.
Picture it, Sicily, 1905. Smooth as the day I was born.
Fabulous. Everyone's arrived and properly groomed. And according to house rules, we would invite the mats to fill in on each side to make 6.
The twink mats scurry about a bit, and then 2 end up on each side.
Wonderful. Would the team captain step forward for the coin toss?
Maurice and Madison step forward.
Madison, our reigning champ, is it tops or bottoms?
Bottoms, always.
And power bottoms, it is. Divas, your serve.
Just remember, girls, pass to me or one of the mats.
And ready, set, serve your volley, girl, real dead.
Sammy Joe serves, Stan returns, and then Krystal Carrington spikes it at Tennessee's face, who cowardly dives for cover.
Ooh, well, I do declare.
And the South falls again.
Play continues in slow motion montage. Stan makes a strong return, only for Madison to spike it at Maurice's face to score. The Golden Girls' twink mats score a point, only for a serve from Krystal to knock Mimi's Sophia glasses off. Dominique elegantly scores a point with her champagne still in one hand. Sammy Joe is positioned for a big spike, and we only see the results through the horrified expressions in the crowd's faces. Maurice and Tennessee seem depressed. Madison scores a point off her huge hat and sneers as Maurice and Mimi dive into each other and fall over.
It's a Moldavian massacre out there, with the Dynasty Divas up 2-0.
It stands serve. Mimi looks at a quivering Tennessee.
I need to call a time out. I must remind my teammates of our strategy.
We don't do timeouts in drag volleyball.
He said time out.
You heard her? 2 minutes.
Mimi gathers her team around her.
My golden girls and mercenary muscle Marys, we're down 2-0. Now, God has perhaps not ordained that we win this battle and keep your home, but picture it, Agincourt, 1415. The end is near for King Kenneth Branagh, and there's no retreat, but they made their stand. And we gave few, all that's left in our band of gold. And with our bond, we shall lose this round with joy and style, and may thus yet win the war. For while some of us may have the bodies of weak and feeble men, we have the hearts and stomachs of queens, and she today that smudges her Revlon with me shall be my sister. And fairies in Rehoboth, still a slumber and overhung, shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and clench their buttocks cheap, whilst any speaks that fought with us upon St. Sebastian's Day! Once more unto the beach, dear friends, to play our parts once more.
The energized team returns to their positions. Stan prepares to serve.
You know, back in St. Olaf, I was on the girls' ice volleyball team. Loot fisk and serve. Try some.
Stan serves it right into Madison/Alexis's face, who spills her champagne. We have another montage. Tennessee returns a volley with her boobs, and while the point is lost, the crowd cheers for her. Mimi whacks the ball out of her way with the Italian cookbook she's reading. Stan misses a point, and Maurice puts her in a headlock, to the crowd's amusement. The volleyball hits Tennessee, and a bunch of condoms fall out of her swimsuit, which she starts tossing into the crowd. Stan scores a point and then shimmies her boobs like the rose gif for the roaring crowd. Sammy Joe spikes it right at Mimi, who lets it bounce off her back to protect the sauce she's stirring and serving the crowd from a pot over a campfire. Sammy Joe looks upset that no one cares about the point she just scored.
It's game point, ladies!
Tennessee dives for the ball and misses, but ends up sliding through a twink mat's legs. She makes a horny face at the crowd, who cheer for her.
And that's the game! Dynasty Divas, you are the winners! Team Captain, please step forward for your winnings.
The crowd claps politely. Madison steps forward and takes the check from Buttery Male's hands. As she takes a victory lap, she passes Maurice.
Get out of my sight, you miserable has-been.
What? Oh, Alexis, how generous! She's donating her winnings to the ACLU!
Dominique struts over in a rage.
Oh, dare you give away our prize, you sow!
Dominique tosses her champagne in Madison's face.
Your champagne is flat.
Alexis slaps back. Krystal intercepts, ripping out Alexis's silicone inserts.
So are you, bitch?
Sammy Joe barrels toward them and pushes everyone toward the water, where they the surf in classic Dynasty fashion.
Cheers for our runners-up, the Golden Girls!
But the Golden Girls have mixed emotions. Buttery Males passes DJ a note.
What's this? It appears the crowd has decided to take up a collection for their own Twink's Choice Award this year. And Golden Girls, you are the popular vote winners. Come collect your cash.
We've channeled the divine feminine crone to victory.
You've won $42.
The hell?
Yeah, you should see their tips.
It's the thought that counts.
Oh, poppets, these things have a way of working out. I have an idea. I would like to invite everyone to an after party at our beach house. This way, darlings.
This is not what I had in mind.
Trust me, you can sell anything to the intoxicated.
The crowd, full of shirtless hunks, hoist the girls up and they cheer and head for the beach house. Interior, Golden Gaze household, Stan's bedroom, the next morning. Stan is sleeping with a face mask. Suddenly, his alarm goes off.
Rise! 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 Rise!
We now see the rest of Stan's king-size bed. Maurice, Tennessee, Mimi, Stan, and a couple twinks from Poodle Beach are sprawled and entangled in the bed. There's party mess everywhere. Everyone but Stan is waking up. Tennessee is holding Stan.
Oh my God!
Suddenly, Maurice and Mimi are scrambling out of the bed. The mostly naked twinks seem to scurry off. Maurice snoozes the alarm and reaches for Tennessee, still holding Stan, who has earplugs and remains asleep.
Get off him! Get off him! Everybody out! Out!
Tennessee slinks out of bed.
Hi, such queer odors in this room.
What happened here last night?
Stan found clients for his roses and his tarot readings. Ten sold his painting of a bedazzled rainbow Josephine binding, based on my pose. And if you check my carpet bag, you might find a certain winner's check made out to my personal affiliate of the ACLU.
I mean, in this bed.
Not Sam. We're family. Family share beds sometimes.
Yeah, family's like the mamas and the papas.
The Golden Gaze all look at each other.
Everybody out. To your own rooms. Can't mean me. You can stay in Tim's walk-in closet.
But
shh. Out. And as my mother would say, after each divorce, we never speak of this again.
They exit Stan's bedroom. Stan remains asleep. The snoozed alarm triggers again.
Rise!
Now Stan snaps up in bed and removes his face mask as he silences the alarm for good.
Where is everyone? Matt? Other Matt?
The twink mats slink out from under the bed where they hid.
There you are. Get in here.
Stan opens his covers to welcome in the twinks.
Hey, Maurice, Ten, everyone!
The trio peeks in through the doorway.
Join me, I got tricks for the house!
Maurice, Mimi, and Ten pile back in the bed like they were never there. Stella the dog follows behind, a twink suit in her mouth. Whimpers, jumps on the bed, and...
Stella!
Stella!
No!
Gives everyone a golden shower. Fade to black.